Hey everybody, it's Comic Crack, and it's good to see you. It's been quite a while. I've been working quite a bit, kind of going from one show to another, and then last week I did some day calls on this TV series that's going right now. So it's just been busy. Haven't really had a chance to watch videos, so I don't really know what everybody is up to, but I have had a chance to read a little bit. When I come home, I usually get an opportunity to do a little bit of reading before I just completely pass out from the day's work. I hope everybody's doing okay, and happy Canada Day, by the way. It's the first when I'm recording this. So I got a package in the mail from Quebec, from our good friend Mark, who does the Underground Comics. And I had a chance to sit and read a couple of them when the package showed up yesterday. It was just before I was heading out the door to go to work, so I just brought it with me. We were in the studio for the past couple of days, and usually things slow down a little bit, especially as I was doing just day calls. So I was kind of the low man on the totem pole. So we always get a chance to kind of set up a stash away from set. And we were playing cards and just sitting and talking and reading and stuff like that. So I had a chance to kind of read a couple of the comics as well as look through them and check them all out. But I also read a couple of things. I think I only posted them on Twitter. I don't think I did a video. I'm pretty sure I didn't talk about them. If I did, I'll talk about them again. I have been reading a lot of back issues and stuff. I've been reading through my stacks of books and catching up on things. And one of the things I've started reading is the Helix titles. And I read Timothy Truman's 6-issue miniseries, The Black Lamb. And I really, really liked it. Just before I read that, I only have one issue of it. I think there was 2 3-part miniseries. I think there were 3-part miniseries of The Spider. And I had found one of them for like $1 or something like that and gave it a try. It's him doing, the Spider is like a pulp character, so he was doing stories based on him. And the one I read was fantastic. I really liked it. Going to hunt them down. Timothy Truman did Scout for, I believe it was Eclipse. Of course, the one he's most well known for possibly is Grimjack. So after I read the Helix series, I really liked that one as well. In the future, there'll be, once I've read through all the Helix titles, I'd like to do a video kind of focusing on that imprint. It's Johnny Zero that turned me onto that whole DC imprint. Great so far what I've read, most of Vermillion. I think I've read some Bloody Mary, and I've read this Black Lamb, and kind of just looked through some of the other ones. But I haven't sat and really dug into the whole thing. I'd like to just read them back to back. I'll do a video where we talk about it for sure. When I was looking up Timothy Truman, just to see what else he had written and what else he had drawn, I came across a whole list of things, and some of the stuff he did was Conan. I've never really read Conan, but the one that kind of jumped out at me to give a shot to was Timothy Truman writing, and one of the artists was Richard Corbin. So I found it at the flea market. This guy had a bunch of Conan volumes. So this is volume number 7 from Dark Horse. And the stuff that Corbin does is the flashback sequences. So I guess it's Conan kind of going through, I'm kind of almost halfway through it, meeting people and either hearing stories about his grandfather or telling stories about his grandfather. Konacht, I think is how you pronounce it. I think that was the name. So Corbin does all that flashback stuff. And it's fantastic to see. There's a little sample there. Excuse me one sec. Touch the phone here so I can see, make sure that you're seeing me properly. Corbin does the flashback stuff and it's pretty great. For the most part, like the art, even the main artist, who is Tomas Giorello, is pretty phenomenal too. You can see there a little sample of his pages. Overall, the story isn't so bad. I've never really read Conan. I've never really had much of an interest in Conan, to be honest. And this doesn't necessarily make me want to rush out and grab some more. It's just okay. But again, it seems like Truman feels a little more at home with like an established character, a pulp type character. Like I said, the Spider, Conan, and even the Black Lamb felt like a little, kind of like a little pulp character. Somebody who had a long history and you're just kind of catching a segment of it. It seems to be where he's comfortable with, at least the stuff that I'm familiar with right now. But I really respond to his writing for the most part. I find it very entertaining. It's not super complex. He's not going for depth necessarily, not that there isn't any, but it just seems a little more kind of on the entertainment side of things, and I really like it. It's really working for me right now. So if you are a fan of Conan, I'd highly recommend that one. The other one that I picked up, which was a really nice surprise, was this Fatal by a guy named Manchette, is the guy who originally wrote the novel, and Manchette also did some stuff that became Jacques Tardi, Run Like Crazy, Run Like Hell, and there was another one, I'm blanking on it now. Anyway, there was a couple of adaptations he did that Tardi did the art for, that I think Fantagraphics has put out both volumes. This kind of I saw it posted, and it was one of those things that, you know, obviously the name stood out to me. The picture of the main character there almost looks like a bit like velvet. So based on that, it was like, what is that about? And I kind of dug a little into it and read about it, and then saw it at the local bookstore just recently and decided to pick it up. The price on the back is $25.99 US, $33.99 Canadian, but I think at my bookstore, I think it was only $25 that I paid for Canadian. So that was a pretty good deal, and it's a hell of a book. If you do see it, and it's more like a crime noir type of thing, but the main character is a female, and it's great. The writing I found, because I read most of that Run Like Crazy, Run Like Hell, and it didn't quite work for me. I'd like to give it another shot now. And the reason why that one didn't work for me was the style of writing was really, I don't really know how to describe it other than maybe like, it was kind of staccato. I don't know if that makes any sense. It was kind of, this almost read like a police report. Suspect scene, leaving house, da da da. It wasn't quite like that, but the way they were, the narration was going sort of read like that. She went out and she bought a blonde wig, bought a dress, came home, ate some dinner, looked at the money, da da da, this sort of thing, like really da 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 da, and very, very descriptive without much color, without much extra around it. So it took me a little bit to get into it, but once I got into it and the story started developing, holy crap, was it good. It had a nice, I don't know, it was a neat angle. I don't want to tell you too much about it because I think that's part of what makes it so good is that surprise. But it just kind of started out a certain way, and as you kind of got the feel for the character and the little town that she was in and what was going on, I really liked it. And by the end, I thought it was a fantastic read. But I mean, that art is very, very nice, you know. And the other thing is, I'm really loving, I know I've said this in videos before, but I'm really loving this format, this hardcover. This one isn't quite oversized like Lone Sloan or something like that, but I'm really loving this kind of one and done story in this hardcover format. The books are really nice. Titan Comics does some good work, man. I've since ordered the first Lone Sloan through my bookstore. They haven't been able to pre-order the third volume. I think it might have got delayed. I'm not quite sure. They were unable to pre-order it for me, though, but I'd really like to check out Titan's website and see what else they're doing, because this is really, really impressive. So if you see this, if you're into kind of crime stories, if you're into noir stories, if you just like something that's a little different, or if you just like European flavored comics, I say go for it. It's a really good read and well worth the money. So that was kind of one of the, that was probably the highlight of my reading from these past couple of weeks. Everything else was great too, but that one really stands out to me. Okay, so maybe I will pause for a moment here and I'll be right back and we'll talk about the stuff from Quebec. Okay, so let's move on to the books that came in the mail. Like I was saying, they came in yesterday just before I was heading to work. Brought them to work, got to open them up and had some time to look through them and read some of them. A couple I've read previously, and then a lot of them, or most of them, were kind of brand new to me, so it was kind of great to see them. As usual, the quality seems to be pretty great. I'm going to go back to the emails to see what grading he was giving these, and just kind of see how it is. But I mean, I trust them so far. The previous time I've dealt with them, there hasn't been an issue, so I trust that everything is fine this time as well. Let's just get right into it. Jack Jackson, who just goes by Jackson, is turning into one of those names in these undergrounds that I'm really, really enjoying. Not only for the fact that he kind of deals a little more with historical fiction, but his art style I find pretty incredible. I'd like to see if there's a book about him. I haven't really done a lot of research on him so far, but one of the series that I've read digitally was this, what do they call it? It has an ad on the back here. In the collection, it's called Comanche Moon, and it's a three-part comic, which is White Comanche is the first issue, Red Raider is the second, and Blood on the Moon is the third and final issue that kind of follows this family. A white mother, indigenous father, or Indian father, and then the two kids. And just kind of follows through their lives. Now, I don't know if these are real people from history, if these are individuals are real from history. I believe they are, but I just don't know, so I don't want to say either way. But it does a good job of setting them in a particular time period, and this is during the, as they say on the cover, during the turbulent Civil War years, young Connor Parker and the Texas Comanches. So the only one that he had, unfortunately, was issue number 2, the Red Raider. I don't know, I think I might have said Red Rider before, but Red Raider. And he doesn't currently have the first or the other two issues. I'm hoping that he's able to find them at some point. I'd like to own all three. But the artwork is incredible. It's one of the things that I respond to a lot with these kind of undergrounds is that for the most part, there's not a lot of advertisements. There's not a lot of room for letters, pages, that sort of thing. It's, you kind of get cover to cover of story. I mean, that was literally the last page of the comic on the back cover. The inside front cover just gives you kind of the brief overview of what's happened so far to kind of give you a little bit of a reminder about the story. So this one was from 1977. I haven't looked to see first printings, that sort of thing. I believe there was only one printing of these, but as usual, don't quote me because I'm not sure off the top of my head. We'll put that down there. Two that he had that I hadn't heard of before were basically a two-part series. The true story of Juan N. Seguin and his fight for Texas independence. So there you go. That's that one. Same thing though, this is really just jam-packed, filled. So this one again is based on historical characters, and there's a list of all the people involved. So I'm assuming, like I said, I don't know anything about these. I haven't read these ones yet. So I'm assuming that a lot of research went into these two books. But again, the same thing with just really beautiful art inside. So that's a two-part series. That's number one. And this one is number two there. And on the back of this one, you get an ad for some of his other work. Comanche Moon is there, and then there's the three comics that make up that series there. These are from 1979 and 1980, I believe. So that's that. Another series, I think I'm now finished this series, Slow Death. This is issue number 10. Each one kind of has a different theme. This one is about cancer and disease in general. And a nice surprise, 1979, Guy Caldwell with a story about herpes, genital warts and all. His usual incredible minimal type of style. I haven't read this issue, but the one that I did read, which I'll talk about in a minute, this is pretty serious stuff. They're anthology books, but they're dealing with serious topics. They're not dealing with, like with some of the books, some of the anthologies, when they do touch on quote-unquote real-life horrors and things, there's usually kind of a step removed. This is pretty much right in your face, addressing these issues and showing, and not pulling any punches whatsoever. Pretty graphic for the most part. So I also got issue number 8, the Greenpeace issue. And then the one that kind of took me by surprise was issue number 7. And this is based on real atrocities that humans have done to each other. And the first story is a Jackson piece again. And it honestly made me gasp out loud, because it's very graphic and very grisly. Again, dealing with quote-unquote Indians, and this side from the white man's point of view and wanting to kind of eradicate them. So they go on a raid of a little village, I guess. And it's just, it's what you'd expect. I'm not even going to show you pictures. It's really, really grisly, but the thing is, it's probably pretty fucking historically accurate. One of the things that me and a few friends of mine loved about The Revenant was its kind of accuracy in portraying the brutality on both sides, but a lot of the brutality that was... a lot of the violence that was done to the indigenous people and in trying to basically wipe them out. Even in that movie, they didn't pull punches, even though the story was kind of focused around a white man. Still, the kind of surrounding, the world that they lived in, was very true to what it would have been like, and probably even worse than that, you know. So it was one of the things that kind of impressed a lot of us. We're big fans of it. We think it's a great movie. I think it's a great movie. Apparently very grueling to work on, but effective nonetheless. Probably because of how difficult it was to shoot it. You're seeing some of that on the screen in front of you. Something that I was pretty excited to get away from the heavy stuff and onto a lighter note. This is a Basil Wolverton mini comic. So here's, just so you get a bit of perspective there. There it is against a regular sized comic. And it is fantastic. It's really great. Right from the get-go, about the artist, and it's Basil Wolverton with his hands and head against a wall. You can't beat that. Great photo. This is from 1973. Additional copies available for 65 cents, postage included. Culture Quickie on the inside with Dr. What was his name? Usual goofy, wacky name. Oh, of course, now I can't find it. Dr. Weaver B. Fever Cleaver. And Dr. Spockter Proctor. Fantastic. I really love Wolverton, as you're all well aware. I just find it really funny, really bizarre. I love the little stories that come under the pictures, all the little captions that describe what the people are trying to do or why they look the way they look. Very, very entertaining stuff. So this is a fantastic little mini comic to add to the collection for sure. I'll put that down there. An artist that I have some stuff of already. It's funny though, because the name doesn't ring familiar to me. Susan Morris. This is from 1972, and this is Tales from the Sphinx. This is issue number 2. And these are incredible pieces of hippie. Let's see if I can see what you're looking at there. It's that, again, kind of on the Basil Wolverton tip. It's that whole spaghetti type detail of hair and things like that that just impressed the hell out of me. These illustrations are fantastic, and the layouts of the pages, and just the kind of psychedelic, drug-induced, hippie, meditational, astral, whatever you want to call it. It's all in here. Really, really great stuff. I just had a look through this issue. I haven't read these two yet. So that's issue number 2 and issue number 3. He didn't have issue number 1. Or maybe he did, but maybe it was a bit pricey. I can't remember. Anyway, 2 out of the 3. Same thing here. Let's just show you a couple of pages in the back. There you go. You can see that there, I'm sure. Great stuff. Really, really great stuff. Excited about that. These next two are all new Underground Comics, and it's issue number 2 and 3, which I've heard are the best out of the series. Issue 1 is apparently not that great, so I passed on it this time, but eventually the completist in me will want to finish it off. So it's, again, another anthology, and it's of people that are new to the Underground Comics at the time, so a little chance for them to flex and show us what they got. This one has a great inside front cover based on like the kicking the sand in the boy's face, and he becomes a bodybuilder. This one is a female, and she gets breast milk squirted at her, so she goes to pump up her breast to be able to show the bully on the beach who's boss later on. Really, really funny. Number 2, and then number 3, which was a flip book. So High School Funnies on one side, and the story, this was the one that drew my attention to it, reading about this particular story. I read this one yesterday, and it really is fantastic. It really, really is of the times. And the art inside is a little reminiscent of The First Kingdom, the Jack Katz, just with a little bit of the style, but like the density of the page and things like that, and the text and all of that. But then there's some fantastic passages here. Basically, this guy wants to get away from the city. He goes out to the country to meet some friends. They've got this, there's this small mountain on their land. And when he gets towards the mountain, he kind of has this overwhelming vision that of what it can look like and what it's supposed to be. And so here on this page is him kind of getting taken in by the potential of this mountain to become kind of a religious symbol and a place of meditation and a place to bring people together in this communal kind of living, all symbolized by this mountain. And here's some more of his visions of what's going to happen when he takes over this piece of land and carves out the mountain for the people. Really, really great, because by the end, the cops want to kick them off the land, and there's a confrontation turns into a riot, and things go from there. But it's a really great little story. But holy crap, is it ever! It's hippie city. Another one that I read, Swamp Fever, from a company that I'm not familiar with, Big Muddy Comics from New Orleans. This one didn't really do much for me. The first story was the best one out of it. Again, kind of a horror anthology. Even has a kind of crypt keeper type of dude paddling through the swamp, leading you from story to story. The first one was great. The rest of it was just so-so. The art in the first one is pretty incredible too. And then also from Big Muddy Comics is Cosmic Capers. And this is another one. It didn't do very much for me at all. There was one gag strip at the back that I thought was entertaining. Right there, just let me touch the screen there. And the rest, again, I mean, you know, when you're dealing with these anthologies and when you're delving into these comics like I have been lately, going for titles that don't necessarily... when you're going for these titles where, with names that you don't recognize and some of these companies that were just kind of a fly-by-night, they put out a couple issues and they disappeared. As fun as that is, you are going to run across some duds. Not that this one is a total dud, because it was entertaining enough, but it's not one that I would recommend. One that I would recommend, though, is All Girl Thrills. And if I'm not mistaken, this was the first comic created by women, all women in the title, including Trina Robbins, who I think was kind of the leader, quote-unquote, who kind of put the team together and put the comic together. And it's quite a read. You can really, there's really a sense of this is early days for these creators. The stories aren't as polished as some of the later stuff from these women that I've read. Even Trina's artwork isn't as polished. I mean, she still has her style, no doubt, but you could tell this is maybe a little bit more early days. But really great nonetheless. Really great issue. Really glad to have it. It's a little beat up, but it's just a good one to have in the collection. There's a split in the spine at the bottom, that sort of thing. But really great. And as usual, because he's a hell of a guy, he gave me a list of a few comics to choose from, and the one that stood out for me was Pro Junior that he then sent to me. It's in great shape, actually. Don Doler's Pro Junior. Apparently it's a character that he created when he was a teenager and was then approached. I guess he befriended a bunch of the underground artists, and this comic was put together by, it says, 22 underground cartoonists who each use his character for a one-page or two-page strip. And everybody does their take on this Pro Junior character. And according to Comics Joint, because there's so many artists, it can be a little disjointed, but an entertaining read nonetheless. Skip Williamson is in here, Robert Crumb is in here, some of the bigger names, Jay Lynch is in here as well. And then obviously, again, the usual with some names that I'm not familiar with. So there you go, that was a really nice gift as well from the man. And that is that. Those are the comics. So thanks very much for watching. I'll be around. I'll try to watch some videos. I'll be on Twitter. This week I've got off, so I'm sure I'll be around here and there, catching up, having some conversations. I'm looking forward to getting back into it. I'll be around tomorrow night for the, I'm hoping for the round table. It's Friday as I'm filming this, so I'm hoping I'll be around to catch that live and maybe chat with a few of you there. But if not, I'll talk to you all real soon. Thanks very much for watching, and we'll talk to you later.